they were already linking pathology in the pineal with precocious puberty. Now, that means that if people, children develop tumours in their pineal, they'll often go into puberty at whatever age they develop it. And this showed, I mean, that itself made the vestigial idea very unlikely. But there are many other things that went against the vestigial theory, one of which is that the pineal has a very high blood circulation. It's got a very elaborate blood circulation, and it's got connections to our visual system. They're not a very direct connection. The connection goes through the visual system and then loops down into the neck, and then there's a sympathetic nerve supply that goes up and connects to the pineal. Now, this was discovered in the 1960s, and really they describe in this book pineology, the era of pineology, starting after the discovery of melatonin. So we're saying that really over the past 40 years there's been an immense amount of research done on the pineal. And what I noticed when I started researching it is that in the 1970s and 1980s, early 1980s textbooks, there was actually a fair amount of information about the pineal. And subsequently in the late 1980s and 1990s, which did coincide with the huge marketing of Prozac, information, a lot of the information that was hard scientific information about the pineal was dropped out of textbooks.
Right, so what is happening in the state of pineal research at the moment that may have precipitated information about the pineal being omitted from medical textbooks?
Mm.
And what are the implications for a new breed of doctors in that regard?
Well, this is one of the things that I have been somewhat surprised by, is the fact that in Melbourne itself that there is quite a bit of research going on the pineal. In Monash University, they're doing trials on melatonin as a, for I think seasonal affective disorder and for jet lag and as a sleeping tablet. This is something that I found out from a magazine called Shares. Shares, Drugs and Money. Cures that will make you a fortune. So there's simply answering your question about economics. There's a group called Circadian Technologies. And it says founded in 1985 and originally listed on the second board, whatever that may mean. Circadian Technologies has spent 12 years developing the hormone melatonin as a treatment for jet lag, sleep problems and fatigue. Melatonin is secreted by the pineal gland and determines the body's circadian rhythms. Work done at Monash University has demonstrated its suitability as a non-addictive, safe sleeping pill. Circadian and Monash are developing the process in a 60-40 joint venture. In 1994, US pharmaceutical giant Eli Lilly signed an agreement with Circadian Technologies to commercialize melatonin. Now, Eli Lilly is the company that produces Prozac. So the link between that is quite obvious.
So this research is being done at Monash, yet within the medical textbooks used by the medical faculty at Monash University itself, there is very little information about the pineal gland and its function for undergraduate medical students to learn from.
Mm. And even postgraduate.
Postgraduate.
Absolutely. Unless people go specifically into the neurosciences as they go higher and higher into researching the neurosciences, they have access, I suppose, to more specialized information, but it shouldn't be, as you said yourself once in the past, that it shouldn't be a game of cat and mouse, that people have to go searching for information about an organ that's so fundamental to our hormonal control. The thing that is quite extraordinary is that this book, which is a very contemporary book, and it's the book that is recommended as a more detailed textbook on the neurosciences. This is an international edition, and it's not for sale in the USA, Mexico, or Canada. and it really goes through a huge amount of detail about the brain. There is another, even more detailed Kendall textbook, a bigger version of it. But this is designed for undergraduates and postgraduates. And it comes from the Center of Neurobiology and Behavior, College of Physicians and Surgeons at Columbia University and the Howard Hughes Medical Institute. Now this book, even though it goes into a lot of detail about the pituitary, it goes on through a lot of details about synaptic function, as well as really virtually every area of the brain, except the pineal. The pineal is not mentioned once in this entire textbook. Now this seems quite extraordinary, because this is a 1995 or 1996 textbook, 1995, and it's an Appleton and Longy publication. The thing that I found, the person who actually alerted me to all of the fact that current textbooks had dropped out information that was in previous editions was actually my mother, who lives in Queensland, who's a zoologist. And she found in my father's textbooks that the current edition of Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine...
Is your father a doctor as well?
My father's a physician in Queensland. That the 1990s edition had actually dropped out information about the pineal that was in the 1980 edition. The argument that people could give is that there is a pressure for space in these books, and there's so much knowledge about medicine that there's no room for...
Even if... so there's no room for the most integral of body parts, the pineal gland?
Well, they would argue that it's not integral. But this is what I've been researching, that there's certainly...
Vested interests in knowledge about the pineal gland.
Yeah. I would say that the research, the people who are doing the research are tied in with looking for pharmaceutical uses of melatonin. And therefore it becomes, you could say, privileged knowledge. And... not something that is shared with the general public, because it's a private research for the pharmaceutical companies.
Right.
That doesn't seem right to me.
Mm. So as a GP doing research into the pineal gland with a forthcoming diagnosis of deluded thought disorder as pinned on you, so to speak, by the psychiatrists at St. Vincent, what are they trying to achieve in making such a diagnosis, and what research have they done themselves?
What research have they done themselves? I suppose you'd have to ask ask them. Maybe you will have an opportunity to do that. I did speak to a psychiatrist last week who's unrelated to all of this, and he said, I didn't think that there was much known about the pineal. I also spoke to the professor of endocrinology at Monash University, Tony Hunter, who told me that he actually takes melatonin for jet lag. But he said, I don't really view melatonin as a bona fide hormone as such. Now, I'm not quite sure what exactly he meant by that, but he didn't know much about the pineal, and he accepted that he didn't know much about the pineal. He's a more diabetes specialist, he said. There are some people. There's a lady called Jenny Redman at Monash University who's doing research on the pineal in the psychology department, but her research, when I spoke to her 2 years ago, mainly involved studies on rats and blocking melatonin production with two different drugs, prazosin and beta blockers, to see which prevented more melatonin production or something along those lines. It wasn't a holistic approach, a general approach towards pineal.
What, a rat's brain is about 100,000th the size of a human brain?
I don't think it's quite as that much smaller, but there are problems with trying to extrapolate from animal studies to humans in quite that way when you're talking about higher mental functions and more complex aspects of thought. I mean, certainly if you're looking about things like perception of truth, I can't see how studying a rat is going to tell you too much about that.
Yeah.